Hi, I'm Kadi Kraman. I'm a developer at Expo, and this is an intro course to React Native. If you've been curious about mobile development but didn't know how to get started, now's the time. All you need is your phone and a computer. No native build tools required. In this course, we'll go through the built-in components like view, text, scroll view, flat list, touchable, and pressable. We'll learn about the built-in styling and use libraries to persist data across app launches, trigger local push notifications, and more. Go out and build real native mobile applications for iOS and Android using JavaScript. Next up, let's talk about components. So components are a React concept and thus also a React Native concept. But basically, if we were to keep building our app and we put everything inside this app.tsx, this file is going to get massive and very difficult to use. So with React, we can have components to create our app as a modular entity. So the common thing to do is we create a components folder, and you can have components in here. So let's call this shopping list item .tsx. So right now, so you need to export a component from here. You could do export default. I think the modern thing to do these days is to do an export, either export const, but as said, I'm using functions for components. So let's do an export function, shopping list item. So you name it the same as the file. And let's return, I'm going to return null for now. And what we want to do is we want to pull this item that we created into our shopping list item component. So let's copy all of this and return it from our shopping list item. And obviously I'm getting lots of ESLint errors. This is what you want ESLint. It will tell you that things are not right, saying that things aren't imported. So I'm going to import view from React Native, text from React Native, touchable opacity from React Native. There we go. And we also need our styles. So let me just copy this whole styles object here. There we go. We need style sheet. And we need to move our handle delete function. And this means we also need the alert from React Native. There we go. And now, instead of having this item here, we can actually import our shopping list item. There we go. Oh, I've forgotten to import theme. There we go, let's import theme as well. So move from here. Okay, so now I can have multiple of my shopping list items. And this is obviously a little bit useless because I have all the items say the same thing. So we want from this app.tsx to say what the shopping list items should be called. So to do that, we can pass it props or properties. And props are passed in, well, let's start it from here. So we'll pass in from here. So let's say this is, I'm going to make sure I name it the same thing. The name, let's call it coffee. What else do we need? Some tea. And some sugar. Okay, so this is giving me a squiggly because it's saying that there is no prop called name. And that's because we haven't defined them here yet. So these get passed in as an object, so we can destructure them in the function as the function arguments, which is really handy. And because we are using TypeScript, we can type them. So I'm going to, this is again a convention, just to do a type called props. And this defines what the properties are. So let's do name, and this name is a string. Notice that we are maybe an hour in. And this is the first bit of TypeScript we've done. So this is not TypeScript heavy, don't worry. But I will mention one thing, that if you want this to be optional, so right now, if I don't pass this in, I'm getting an error. If I wanted this to be optional, I would do a question mark. So this allows me to not pass it in. In our case, we want to make sure that people always pass in a name. So we're going to make it a mandatory argument. And in our text, instead of coffee, let's use this property. So if you want to render any text in line, you put it into these curlies, and then it renders the thing that you, renders the string that you passed in. So rendering a screen as a modal means rendering it on top of other content. So important thing to note that in order for this to work, the modal needs to be defined above or adjacent to the screens it's being rendered on top of. So in particular, if you have a bottom tabs navigator and you have a stack inside your bottom tabs and you make one of those screens a modal, it won't get rendered on top of your app. You need to define it at the top level. So in our case, our structure is quite flat. So we can change any of these screens to be rendered modally by using the options. So I've actually not even defined the screens here. And actually, this is, again, a good example. So this is something that throws off people initially, because especially when you're coming from React Navigation, you think that you need to define the screens for them to exist. But because we're using file system-based routing, you'll see that all this navigation works even though these screens aren't even defined. So the only reason we really define them is to add additional properties here. So let me copy these so I could do our counter and our idea. So counter, idea. And this will change this heading that is rendered. And let's pass in presentation modal. So whoever asked earlier about how to do your own custom alerts, then this is how you do them. So you can render a screen as a transparent modal, and then the content of the modal will be the alert. So let's do modal. And now if I go to counter, you'll actually see that it gets rendered on top. And if I do another presentation modal here as well, then there you go, you get the modals all the way down. And the interesting thing about this is that on Android, again, this actually looks different. So this is rendering a modal, but it looks similar to a screen. So this, again, is not a bug. It's just the Android appropriate navigation. You can change how these screens are presented by using the animation. So there's a couple, you can configure your own animations, you can build your own, this is supported, but there's a couple here that are built in. So for example, I could use a fade animation. So if I go to counter, this will render as a modal, but then it will fade in the other screen. So let's try a different one. Slide from bottom, let's do that one. There you go, so now we get slide from bottom here, and then on Android, you actually get this to start from slide from bottom as well. So if you do want it to slide from bottom on the Android, this is how you do it. Now let's schedule a notification. So I've switched this from my iOS simulator to the screen mirroring of my Android phone, so we could see how we're testing the push notifications. Right. So here, instead of handle request permission, let's call this schedule notification. And what we're doing is we're checking if we can schedule a notification. So if result is granted, and I'll do an else. So this is to do. But I'll do an else here as well. So I'll just do a quick alert that says unable to schedule notification and enable the notification permission for Expo Go in settings. And actually, it might be worth, I didn't do this in example app, but it might be worth adding a if device. How do we do this here? Yeah, if device is device. So this is device from Expo device. So I just don't want to get this alert on a simulator. So if is so if it is a device, then we'll give the alert. Otherwise, we can just fail silently because it will be on a simulator, so we'll be the ones doing it. All right, so if it is granted, we want to schedule a notification. So this will be asynchronous, so we'll await notifications. Occasions. We should import notifications, so let's import star as notifications from Expo notifications. And we'll want to await notifications, schedule notification async. So this will schedule a local notification for ourselves on our device. And for the content, we can pass in a title. So this will be, I'm a notification from your app. Let's add a little emoji here as well. And then the other config option that we're going to pass in is the trigger. So when do we want to trigger it? You can look at the docs. Actually, when we can look at the docs now. So, extra notifications, there we go. So, the trigger. So, you can do like you can pass in the like amount of seconds. You can pass in a daytime. So, we go to daytime. So, this will be the input. There we go. So, you can do a date, you can do a time interval, you can do a daily push notification, a weekly, a yearly, or like a particular second or a particular timestamp. So, look at the docs, this is actually quite flexible when you can schedule it. But in our case, let's just trigger it after 5 seconds so we could see it immediately. All right. So, should probably rename our button as well. So let's call this schedule notification. Lovely. So now let's see, I don't have any settings. Can I get rid of this? Okay, lovely. So notifications. So I'm going to schedule a notification. So one thing to note is that foreground and background notifications are treated differently. So when your app is open, your background notification isn't going to end up in your notifications bar. So I'm going to press the button and immediately background the app. So press the button, background the app, and then open the notifications bar. So I'm hoping I get a notification here. There you go, I'm a notification from your app. So when I open this, it will open the app. And it will work the same on iOS, I promise.